is also where a notorious serial killer dumped the bodies of most of his victims, one by one. He became known as the Genesee River Killer.
Once you kill somebody, killing somebody else is snap your finger.
His name is Arthur Shawcross. Over a two-year period, he instilled fear throughout the city as he murdered at least 11 women.
I was convicted of 11, suspected of 19 more. Not going no farther.
He preyed mostly on prostitutes, strangling and suffocating them with his bare hands.
They weren't kicking at all. You get the pressure point, you don't move.
He mutilated some of the bodies and even claimed to have eaten their flesh.
I don't know why I did it. Just something happened in the spur of the moment. That was it.
We'll be right back. were to take an even more sinister turn.
You know, the one that I remember the most, and that's stuck with me all these years, is a young woman by the name of June Stott. And June was not a prostitute, but she was a little slow. She had acted much younger than her age. I think the thing that was most disturbing about it is that when her body was turned over, she was on her stomach. When they turned her over, he had come back and eviscerated her, cut her open right from the neck right down to the vagina.
That was a fit of anger. You know, we spent a day down Turning Point Park, you know, feeding the ducks, walking around, and we're making out. Then she just flipped. You know, jumped up, says, "I'm going to scream, I'm going to tell the cops." And yeah, snapped her neck. Stayed there all day until dark. Then, split her open from her neck to her groin. I didn't go all the way deep into the stomach area, just split her open, I don't know why.
Yeah, it was really disturbing because if you at that time we didn't know what we were looking for. Now you got.
Highway and I'm driving along, there's not a car near me. It's totally alien county. This is way up around Eureka or something. And there's these two probably high school girls. They looked up to be 17 or 18 years old. They're hitching the first ride into town because they've snuck off the farm. They've gone the half a mile or so out to the road, and they're going to hit on into town, have a good time, and sneak back. It was obvious because they were grabbing the first ride they could get. And here I've been fighting my inner impulses to not go off on this woman and her 12-year-old son who's hitchhiking clear back to Seattle, right? And I'm struggling with these feelings. I don't want to do it. Man, you ought to do it anyway. You're weak. You're a punk. I don't want to do it. All day long I'm doing this. And by the time I'm coming back down that highway, I'm exhausted. I'm saying, oh, whoa. And I'm driving along just to get home. And here's a perfect situation.
He would pick up sex workers and murder them and then dispose of their bodies in clusters. So there would be dump sites where there were several bodies of his victims.
The next group that we found was on the Starlake Road. He would park on a curve so that he could see in both directions, and then he would carry the bodies out and deposit them.
Ridgway later confessed to having had sex with the bodies after death, in some cases, long after.
The necrophilia, having sex with a dead person, is extraordinarily rare. And it's one of the pieces of the puzzle that suggests true psychosis. To engage in necrophilia, you have to be completely out of touch with reality.
Ridgway would often revisit the bodies of his victims multiple times. He would move them. He would have sexual relations with the bodies. It's absolutely ghastly.